Hello, everybody. Welcome to the TAC Cup Future Stars for the TAC. Slow it down the roads this afternoon. Sit back, put the feet up, and enjoy the next hour of the pathway of AFL football and the most elite competition, the TAC Cup, and other great journeys, including Sam Doherty, who will join us from the Blues very, very soon. Football's father figure, Kevin Shifter Sheen from the AFL Development System. Welcome, Shifter.
Yeah, Hutchie, pleasure to be with you. And the draft's now on the radar. On Friday, 96 letters went out inviting youngsters from around Australia to our draft combine. And many of those in the mix were TAC Cup future stars. So more on those numbers and all about that a bit later in the show.
Our list manager here is the great of Hawthorn Bulldog and Tiger fame from yesteryear, Terry Wallace. Now our list manager as well. And the Evolution Series today, player.
Yeah, look, it's been multicultural around over the 2 weeks of round 18. And it's amazing just to sort of see how many players have come from international background.
One of the greatest graduates ever of the TAC Cup is the Brownlow medalist in Jimmy Bartel. He's part of the team here and he joins us. G'day, Jim.
G'day, mate. Thanks for having me.
Good to have you along and good memories from your times at the Geelong Falcons. You've been one of the rare ones who've never had to leave your hometown to play.
No, it was very close for me to move down the road, literally. And yeah, I was very fortunate as well to play with some very good players who have gone on to have great AFL careers.
We're going to have a look at that in just a moment. Big round of football in the TAC Cup as we look at the results from the round of football. Round 15, the Calder Cannons with a nice win there over the Chargers. The Jets did it comfortably. Falcons just hanging in, 5-point win. Bushies over Tasmania, who went round this weekend. The Gippsland Power back in the winner's circle with a 4-goal win over the Northern Knights, and the Dandong Stingrays got the job done against the Sandringham Dragons. The latter, as it sits, with the Chargers, with the second loss now on top, the Cannons and the Stingrays, the Ballarat, North Ballarat Rebels and the Geelong Falcons. So the country teams of Ballarat and Geelong the Movers and the Gippy Power up to 10th with a rocket with that win yesterday. So we'll catch up with those results throughout the course of the program. I mentioned the Falcons in your time there. I want to take a look. I know you love the going through the files here, Shifter, and pulling out some great vision. But your days at the Falcons, what do you remember?
Oh, I remember going down there, and it's, everyone remembers is Mick Turner, yeah, running the Falcons factory, as Brian Taylor likes to call it a lot. But there's a lot of good players I got to play with. In my first year, Amon Buchanan was one who went on to play Swans, had a massive final series. But probably had in my second year, Gary Ablett, Luke Hodge, Matt Maguire, just to name a few. Nick Maxwell, the recently retired Collingwood Premiership captain.
When you see Nick Maxwell retire, does that sort of, is it a wake-up call in your football mortality?
Oh, I didn't need him to retire to get the wake-up call. I know I'm getting a bit old and long in the tooth, and you know, kids who are getting drafted now, I probably gave a footy clinic to in grade two, so yeah, you know where you stand in the game.
Well, talk about getting a bit older. How's the week off? Everyone else is complaining in the football world because they've got a week off. I'm tipping that the players would like it.
Yeah, look, I understand the supporters don't like it because they love football 24/7 and the AFL likes to keep the momentum. But from a player's point of view, the rest is vital, especially this time of year. It's been a long year. If you had the pre-season games, it's not, you know, round 17 or 18 for the players. It feels about round 27 and they need the spell. But the good thing is you'll see the better players playing more often if you have the two buys in the game instead of being managed or rested throughout the season.
Now, Jimmy, we'll pick up your pathway. It's 2000, you're down there at the Falcons. You're a 17-year-old and you're playing a premiership side. What do you recall of that year, 2000?
Yeah, we're a pretty young side. I know at the start of the year, I don't think a lot was thought of that Geelong Falcons group. We're pretty small as far as size goes. Damien Christensen, Alan Christensen's uncle, was our Falcons coach. It was his first year down there. And we just had a really good group of players who'd played a lot of senior football in country leagues at a young age. And we had a really physical side and we went to win the premiership. And yeah, so we had a good year our first year.
And by the next year, you were the captain of the side. You end up a back-to-back All-Australian in the National Championships. But I want to know what you're like as a scout, because you had a couple of guys who were a bit younger than you, 1 year younger, a kid from Mottawarri and a kid from Colac playing for you. You recall those two. Tell us about young Gary Ablett and young Luke Hodge.
Yeah, Gary Ablett from Mottawarri, he was a fantastic player. He probably handballed the ball a lot more, as everyone spoke about in under-18s. He just loved bringing teammates into the game. He was pretty small, but he had huge ability. No one could tackle him back then. He just made the game look effortless and easy. And of course, Luke Hodge, Mick Turner's favourite. He still is adamant he's the best player he'd have come through, and he's pretty well right. At 16, he played like a man. He could play like he does for Hawthorn. He could go down back, he could go in the midfield, and Yeah, been pushed forward and kicked vital goals for us then.
In the early days of the under-18s, did you fancy yourself having a modelling career somewhere along the line? Because we might have just got this shot to have a look at.
Yeah, it looks very posed, doesn't it? With the shaved head there, it's a bit rough. But every week the Herald Sun used to promote the TAC Cup, which was great, and they'd pluck a player from a team, and it was my turn that week, and very modelish, yeah, didn't it? Yeah.
I reckon you set the photo in. I reckon you've been doing it ever since. Let's have a look at the Mornington Telstra Store Goal of the Week competition. Goal of the Year at the end of the year is going to be unbelievable. You get to vote all the way through until 2 o'clock tonight. Let's have a look at the contenders this week, boys.
Yeah, and I've got Jaden Foster first up here. I think right place, right time for this one. Or maybe it's forward line pressure. He reads it well, chops it off, and Jaden Foster, the son of Peter, pops it through nicely.
Yeah, well, I've got the second nomination, which is Josh Dunkley, just coming up here. Just a nice bit of reading of the play first up, and then we're still in a bit of World Cup mode with the soccer off the ground. Really well designed and well planned. If you have a look at it, it has a look at the goals, and straight off the ground, beautiful goal.
And I've got the final one, Braden Hodgson from the Murray Bush Rangers. The ruckman here, great work for a change from a ruckman to actually put it in the path of a midfielder. Nice running goal from 60 metres out there at Rams Arena, or Craigieburn as some people know it as out there. It's pretty hard to get any goal straight out of the middle that quick, and 60 metres finish in any conditions is fantastic effort.
So there you go. It's up to you at home to vote on this, on the Mornington Telstra Store Goal of the Week. You can get on the Facebook page, facebook.com/Mornington Telstra Store. facebook.com/Mornington Telstra Store. We'll put a link on our Facebook page in case you can't find it, but you will. Pete and his team do a fantastic job there. If you get a free $200 prepaid Visa, we'll be going there and buy something too. Foster, Dunkley or Hodgson, you must like the page to be eligible for the great prizes. And at the end of the year, the winning player will receive a major prize pack from Sony valued over $3,000, which will be presented right here on the program at the end of the season. So get on the page, like the page, and vote for 1, 2, or 3. Sam Doherty of the Blues has been a sensation this year. He joins us next on TAC Cup Future Stars.
He's a goal kicker, but he's found some teammates.
Well, he might have just found Doherty in Ray. So a little bit of personal pressure here for the young lion. From inside 50. Oh, it goes left and comes back right. It wasn't pretty, but it's all clear, one goal. He's on the board in the AFL.
Half forward flank with three bounces. Then he spears a pass in towards the half forward line. Kicking from around 46 metres. Looks pretty good. Daisy Thomas likes it in the square. He likes it as well. He gets his first. Carlton surge further ahead.
Well, it's been a brief but eventful and exciting career so far for our next guest, Sam Doherty, who has come back to Carlton after a short stint at Brisbane, and he joins us on TAC Cup Future Stars to relive his journey. Welcome, and I guess a tough team here for the Blues, but congratulations on your own form. You've settled in beautifully.
Yeah, firstly, thanks for having me. It has been a tough year, but we're on the mend. Hopefully play some good games towards the end of the year and get ready for next year as well.
We're going to go back into your journey. I think we probably should start at Brisbane. 2 years there. How did you find it overall? Was it tough? Did you enjoy it? What made you want to come home?
Yeah, it was tough. When I was drafted, I had to get hip surgery straight away, so that put me out of pretty much all of the pre-season. So I really found that tough, trying to sort of balance getting around the group and then getting my injury right as well. And then that obviously impacted my first year. And then to play games my second year was really good. I just found it a bit hard to get consistent footy. I wasn't playing as well as I wanted to be. I probably wasn't as happy as I wanted to be either up there. Obviously coming back home now, playing a lot better footy, a lot happier being at home. So it's been a good year for me personally, but obviously, as we were saying before, it's a bit tough for the club so far.
And a lot said about the fact that it wasn't just you. I mean, there was four or five guys that left the club at the one opportunity. Was there enough chances given to you guys, or was there enough painted or presented about what you were the part that you were going to play in the future?
No, I think the club sort of gave the opportunities that were warranted. Obviously, we probably weren't playing good enough to be playing in the team, which is, it's up to the coaches to select you. It's, you can't just get a game on your talent or the pick you were. So I personally understood why I wasn't playing. Obviously, my second year I did play a bit more footy. I was just sort of in and out, which is a bit tough for a younger player. The other boys, everyone was sort of a different example of why they left. There's boys that wanted to come home to family. There's guys that weren't getting an opportunity up there. But yeah, everyone was a bit different. It wasn't one reason that everyone left.
For you, you were also sort of saying that you didn't click in Brisbane. What does sort of that mean? Why couldn't you settle up there?
I'm not sure. I found it a lot harder than what I thought it would be. Going up there, I thought that I'd settle in very easy. Being a country kid, I'd get up there and enjoy the whole thing. But I sort of, being at the club was everything. It's one thing I've noticed since I've come back to Melbourne, you sort of have a bit of a life, you have a lot of a life outside of footy compared to just the footy club. Whereas I found in Brisbane, that was, the whole culture is just everyone's in together, which it really works for some people, but some people it doesn't. Some people like having their sort of stuff outside of footy, and I guess that was me. I preferred to have a bit of stuff outside of footy and the club so you can sort of mix and match.
Sam, you're a talented player and you would have been in demand from a lot of clubs, especially in Victoria coming back. Why did you pick Carlton? Why was Carlton number one for you?
Well, I interviewed with about four or five, and just going through the interview process and stuff, Carlton were the best fit for me. I thought there was an opportunity to play regular footy. I thought last year they played finals, so I thought there'd be an opportunity to play finals as well. So they sort of, I went through with my manager about what was the best fit out of the clubs that I interviewed with, and Carlton was the best fit, and obviously been a pretty good choice because I've been able to play this year. So,
has it been the right move for you, do you think? No looking back?
Nah, there is no looking back. I'm very happy down here in Melbourne and I'm very happy to be at the club. So.
Well, you've had a fantastic season so far. You started off, obviously, the injury interrupted again, so you haven't had a really full crack at it. You'd have you with a pre-season and then 22 or 23 games, but your form's been terrific.
Yeah, obviously, yeah. I had a couple of operations in the off-season, which wasn't ideal. I came to the club as fit as I have been so far in my career, and then just had a bit of unlucky run through from December to February, really. And then since I've been able to get into the team, my body's been really good. It's held up pretty well without having a pre-season, which I've actually been quite surprised with. But it's been good to play. I think I played 11 in a row now, which in Brisbane the most I'd play in a row was 3. So it's been good to play continual footy, and I think my form's going from just playing the games week in, week out.
Now, Sam, we want to pick up on your journey, and you come from a part of Victoria better known for probably the MotoGP and Penguins than football, because you come from Phillip Island, and you played as a 15, 16-year-old at the Phillip Island Footy Club at senior level. Tell us about Phillip Island footy.
Yeah, I played under-15s as a bottom age and top age. We actually won the flag in my top age year undefeated, and then straight out of that, I was lucky enough to transition straight from under-15s into seniors. I only played about 3 under-18 games for Phillip Island. What's happened now is I got in the team and I just stayed in the team. The culture there, I was playing with, we were really young at that time. Like, I was playing with probably 5 or 6 of the boys that were just a little bit older than me, like my brother and all his mates. So we sort of all played as a little group in the team, and we played most weeks. I think we made finals both the years that I played there before my TAC Cup. And just missed out on the grand final by a kick after the siren.
Then in 2011, you get to Gippsland Power. It's your 18th year. Tell us a bit about playing for Gippsland Power. And I then want to pick up on how you made a grand exit into Vic Country in the middle of the year. But let's look at some vision of you playing for Gippsland Power. Tell us about that.
Yeah, I was actually very lucky in the end to only play the 1 year of Gippsland Power. The travelling you have to do to play at a country TAC Cup club is actually quite taxing on your school and your life outside of footy. I was lucky enough to play the 1 year and play well enough to get drafted. Obviously, I went from not really being known at the start of the year to playing, as you said, the game in Vic Country at the end, which really put up my draft stock. So I was very lucky with firstly getting picked up and playing, and then to be able to get the opportunity to play at national carnival level after 8 or 9 TAC Cup games.
And we'll see some vision of that, because it was a breakout game, an unbelievable game. You were best on the ground for Vic Country against WA. It put you on the radar. It was on Foxtel. Everyone's watching it. And this guy, who didn't even have the number in the record, matched up with the name, played a sensational game. What do you recall of that day?
My name had another... Well, my number had another name on it in the record, which I was worried about at the time that if I played well, that they'd think it was someone else. But, I was lucky enough to get in, and I sort of just continued my form that I was playing at TAC Cup level, and I was very lucky to be able to play and play well. So, yeah.
So that's setting up a draft, but of course you had no expectation at the start of the year about a draft because you'd booked a holiday to Bali at draft time. Tell us about how you heard that you'd been chosen. Where were you, etc.?
Yeah, well, at the start of the year, I was booking my schoolies trip away like every 18-year-old does at school. I had no thought about getting drafted. I was just happy to play at Gippsland Power. I was lucky enough, it was a bit of a task trying to explain to the clubs that I was going for a surfing trip away with my mates to Bali exactly when the draft was on. But so about a week over being there, I was sitting by a laptop. My mates were all drinking, sitting in the pool, and I was sitting there stressing over where I was going to go. After got picked up from Brisbane at pick 12, and then I had Vossi calling me on the phone, and there was about a 30-second delay between what he was saying, what I was saying. So I really didn't understand much at all. From there, pretty much got on the first flight back, the red eye, straight back to Melbourne. Met with Rob Kerr at the airport, who gave me all my gear, and then 3 days later, I was travelling back up to Brisbane. So.
What a fantastic story. Stick around a little bit, Gippsland Power, your old boys. Yesterday, in action, we had a win yesterday. I say, well, I'm a Gippslander as well. how far is the trip from Phillip Island to the Gippsland set-up in Morwell, by the way? Is there a big win yesterday with Dunkley kicking four and was best on the ground?
Yeah, it's about 2 hours when you're driving, but you put a bus in there. I used to get a bus after school, and it's about 2.5 hours on a bus after school.
Well, it's a big credit to your infrastructure around you and all the great support people at the Gippsland Power. We should take a lot of credit for you getting drafted, player. It was a good win yesterday.
My word, and they're able to get the job done, 11th versus 10th. So they're pretty well matched, and that's the way that it looked in the first half of the game. It was only 4 points between the two sides at half time, but they really just motored away in the second half and got a solid 4-goal victory eventually. We had a look at Josh Dunkley in the goals of the week. He's playing a fine season down there, 26 possessions, 4 goals again. He's a 17-year-old, so he won't be eligible till next draft year, but a real fine player, got a big, strong body on him already.
He looms, if the system doesn't change this year, as the first player who will be held accountable under the father-son changes.
Yeah, well, Father Andrew, superstar, wasn't he? Is a great defender for the Sydney Swans. He's eligible there, but he may do a Mark Murphy. Who knows? He may go in the open draft. That's all for next year, of course. But he has a super year. He won the Cameron Ling Medal, Jimmy, as the most highly rated player at 17 this year by his peers playing in the NAB AFL Academy.
Tom Papley, 4 goals. That name, Papley, synonymous to VFL, AFL football. Darcy McPherson's a good one. I like the way that he's going about his footy. Only 16-year-old still, so playing some really good football, and I think he's one to really watch. There's a player missing yesterday for the Northern Knights. Rhys McKenzie, we spoke about him the other week. He kicked 10 goals. Where was he yesterday?
Well, he played for Marcelo on the Friday and kicked a lazy 16, don't mind.
16
on the Friday for Marcelin College. Bolton Pelly kicked 10 last year, so he surpassed that, so that's
well,
quite a game.
Surely he's going to be father-son to Carlton, isn't he? His dad, Warren, played with Carlton.
Not quite enough games, I'm afraid. 67-odd games, a premiership player, but no, that does not qualify you under the current rules, Hutchie.
Could change?
Oh, no, I wouldn't think the eligibility of 100 games, Mike, but...
Now, Sam, footy clubs love a prank, and I'm sure you're one who enjoys a footy club prank. Can you tell us a bit about the one we just see here?
Yeah, this is actually when I came home to Phillip Island, and one of my mates, we decided to go to his house, and there's glad wrap all around his car and threw some toilet paper on there. We thought were hilarious, but we've had some good ones up in Brisbane. Some of the boys put open pizzas on the front of cars and woke up the next morning and it was destroyed the windscreen, so... But yeah, clubs love it. It was a good one at Geelong, wasn't there, when one of the boys got in trouble about it?
Yeah, they went to knock on someone's door and play a bit of a prank, but they got the wrong house and the police were called. So.
Thanks for coming in, Sam. Appreciate your time today and well done. You get all the prizes, including from Mac Boots. You get the Show You Earth Who's Boss with a pair of Mac Boots built like a Mac truck. And Buddy Tuff, the Faster Pasta. $100 voucher used at the Faster Pasta restaurants. The Platform 28's a fantastic pub. It'll do magnificently while the Isle of Wight's being rebuilt down there at Phillip Island. Magnificent $100 meal voucher. The Soho House, excuse me, not Soho House, Soho. Sammy Soho, the $100. Sammy is the man. He'll be happy with his Hawks. Kingston Links Golf Course, great round of golf. The Diadora Net Breathing System shoes, magnificent. The Parkview Hotel voucher, one night at the Parkview and you'll be back. No doubt about that. And the Uber voucher, $50 Uber voucher to get you home nice and safe. And in the comfort of a private car. And if you want a lift at home on us, there you go, Uber Future Stars. Download the code a $20 lift on us and safe driving in your Uber as well. Thanks very much again, Sam, for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
Plenty more to come. The Evolution Series up next on TAC Cup Future Stars. For the TAC, speed hurts. Keep within the speed limit at all times. Welcome back to TAC Cup Future Stars. It's time now for the Evolution Series with our list manager on the program, Terry Wallace. Plough, multicultural round has been fascinating and it's been some wonderful performances over time too.
Yeah, look, it's been brilliant over the 2 weeks. I've been all around Australia. We had the Irish girls dancing up there at the Giants ground. Certainly we had the Indian Bollywood dancers at Etihad Stadium last week. We just sort of see some of the pictures there. Jimmy, you got an involvement in this as an ambassador.
Yeah, I come on board this year with Job Watson, as well as the guys like Basha Hooley, who are doing some fantastic work in this space. And it's just really to make the game inclusive for everyone, because we are Australia's game and we want everyone participating.
Well, just the shot of the footy record there with current day players and some kids involved. Really, it's quite fascinating when you have a look at the history behind all this, Shifter, about where people have come from and their heritage in the game.
Well, I recall just as a kid that my introduction to the game was a swap card of Sergio Silvani. It must have been in the 60s. And I looked at it and it connected me to the game to say, well, OK, that's what they play in Melbourne, that game. And to think that then Stephen later on makes the AFL team of the century. The Sauce, of course, is one of the great fullbacks in the game. So I remember the Italian connection from very early on.
Well, we'll have a look at some of the early pioneers of the game. We could go all the way back to 1897. The first round of 1897, there was in the Fitzroy side, there was an English, an Irishman, a West Indian, a Mauritian, and 16 Aussies. So it's been multicultural since almost its inception. And some great names, Jimmy, in that lot.
Yeah, one that stands out pretty big there is Ron Barassi, one of the biggest names in football history.
And you have a look at Alex Jezelenko from Russia, some absolute fabulous ones.
Yeah, and of course, Jimmy Steyn's arguably the greatest story of success in our game. His playing story of being overlooked at the start, winning a Brownlow medal, the game's record holder in a row of 244 games on the trot. He was just an iron man, wasn't he, as a player, and a wonderful legend of Melbourne Football Club and of the AFL.
Well, what probably surprised me, I mean, those players had international heritage, but I was quite surprised by the amount of players that are actually born overseas. 26 players have actually been born overseas, and you know, there's some really good names in this lot as well. When you think of Jim Mike Pike coming from an international sport to come across and play Australian rules.
Yeah, and last night he played on probably the biggest stage and one of the biggest games of the year so far at the MCG, 70-odd thousand. And he played actually international rugby for Canada, scored a try against New Zealand. We've seen that footage a few times. But it just shows there is a good pathway if you've got the talent and the skill.
Quite a lot of different nations, and the US boys are now on display as well.
Well, is it the next frontier? Mason Cox, a storm, wasn't it, during the year when he actually signed with Collingwood? He'll be out in August, the 211-centimetre guy having a crack to play in the ruck. And, of course, the other three boys are out at clubs. Great to see that Sydney, St Kilda and North Melbourne are taking the punt on finding a ruckman out of the States.
Hearing big things about Eric Wallace's progress too at the Kangaroos.
He really has made some ground. I remember watching him in the first few games that he played, and I just wondered how far the experiment could go, but certainly has made a lot of ground in recent times. You then go on and just sort of have a look at the pathways or where we're expanding the game to, I suppose, Shifter, and it's quite fascinating. You know, we go all the way back, Jimmy, to the days of the Irish experiment, and you know, I think Shifter just mentioned Jim Steins, but we've got a lot of Irish players now coming through the system.
Yeah, and last night, Piers Hanley, 47 possessions. He actually looks a lot more skilled than guys who've been growing up with the game. You know, they're talented, they're physical, and they've got the running capacity as well.
South Africa's an interesting one. We've taken the game into South Africa, Shifter.
Yeah, and I think it's fantastic, but it's mainly played in the townships and it's community development. Wonderful to see 20,000 kids in townships right around South Africa without much sporting opportunity getting the chance to play. But it's a massive step to actually become an AFL player out of that. But I think it's very noble what's occurring over there for the good of the game.
And we spoke about the big boys from the US. How will that process go going forward?
or going forward, we've locked away the month of April to actually screen players. That's happened again earlier this year. Cox come out as a result of it. Two further players have been invited just this weekend to come out to our draft combine and to be shown off to the clubs in September and October. So two more would expect that potentially can be signed, and they'll be tall boys, potential ruckman, potential key defenders.
So sky's the limit on where all that can be sort of taken to in the future. Just happens to coincide multicultural around with the fact that this year, every 3 years, the International Cup's on, and it just happens to fall in this year. So there's 900 players from 18 countries that'll be involved in this series, and, you know, obviously there's a bit of a list of the countries that are going to be here. I don't know whether you'll have an opportunity, Jimmy, but on their grand final day, the International Cup grand final, they're playing before the Hawthorn and Geelong game.
Yeah, so it'd be fantastic. They get the experience, big crowd, the MCG, the home of footy, and they can go back and pass on the message of how great our game is and how much everybody loves it here. And if we can, you know, spread the bug of AFL football overseas, the better.
And Shifter, the Irish boys have been able to win this series twice, and just sort of seeing a bit of vision. They actually got up in 2011, the last time that the series was on, and a bit of celebration going on there.
And didn't it mean something to them? I love watching these games. The passion that people have for Australian football, for the AFL, is enormous. And they mightn't be as talented, they mightn't be elite players, many of them, but, gee, it doesn't stop them from absolutely loving the game and celebrating great victories.
Well, if you want to get out and have a look at some of the games, look, it's just a great sort of environment to go. And that's the international fixture of when these games will be played. Obviously, there's a women's grand final that's going to be played at Punt Road Oval as well. So get involved. I mean, it's what a great opportunity. If you love your football, get involved on an international flavour.
Fantastic player. It's been fascinating to see so many players come through the international system. Hopefully, we'll find a couple this year. Shifter will be there with the binoculars, keeping a close eye on some of the great young kids from around, and players from around the world. And well done to Jimmy for being involved in Multicultural Round as well. Don't forget the Telstra Store Mornington, the Mornington Telstra Store Facebook page. Get on and vote for the goal of the week. You've got around about 20 minutes to go before we close off voting. Please like the page, Mornington Telstra Store, while you're there. When you head down and see Pete and his team, also you can win a prepaid Visa gift card. So get into the store, but vote Foster, Dunkley or Hodgson. And they could be goal of the week and go in line for the goal of the year. $3,000 thanks to Sony. Up for grabs at the end of the season. All the action from the TAC Cup still to come for the TAC. Speed hurts.
G'day and welcome to another edition of the 7-Eleven Slurpee Shootout. I'm Chris Dills from the Melbourne Footy Club and I'm joined today by Will Fordham from the Sandringham Dragons. Will,
right. How are you, mate?
I'm good, thanks. How are you?
Yeah, really well, mate. Okay, Will, mate, are you familiar with Paper, Scissors, Rock?
I am.
All right, let's see who goes first. Paper, Scissors, Rock. I'll start off. Bending.
Oh, he's hit the poster. Oh no.
One point apiece.
Risky. Oh, that's a nice score, surely. Oh!
Out of bounds on the ball. Shattering.
I might have to go to the right foil on the ground, I reckon.
He's hung it out there too much.
Oh,
still
no.
Candy point. I'm in his head.
This is pressure.
Oh, straight through the middle. Oh. Do you always look this nervous when you go for goal?
Yeah, I reckon. That's coming back. That's beautiful. That is absolutely magnificent.
Yeah. Pretty close battle at the moment, Will. It's one goal one to one goal two.
Yeah, I reckon I've got you covered. Oh, he's on.
Just don't think about the right post.
There we go. That's more like it. I'm going for that one.
Beautiful.
This is what I wanted.
All right, well, we're down to the final kick. Will's got me covered by a point at the moment, but everyone's favourite kick is the 7-Eleven super kick. Goal's worth 7 points. If I can hit that sign, it's worth 11. I think I'm going to need a bit of magic here.
This is... Down the full, to the right.
He's looking good, Will. Oh, I'm too strong. Just don't kick a point, you're pretty much safe. That no score. Oh, put it to the ruckman in the goal square.
That's what happens when you go a bit of a weak foot.
Well, there you have it. Came down to the final kick in a close battle. Bad luck, Will.
Thanks,
but, mate, you don't go home empty-handed. You get the 7-Eleven VIP card.
Beautiful.
Free Slurpees for a month.
Thanks, mate.
Good luck for the rest of the season, mate. Look forward to seeing you kick a few goals in the TAC Cup.
You too.
And back to you, Hutchie.
Thanks, Chris. Well played too. Came into his first 7-Eleven Slurpee shootout and just did it easy, the big fella. Good character he is from the Demons too. For your chance to win great prizes and hear too about the latest flavours and events, follow the innovative team at Slurpee Australia on Facebook and Slurpee AUS on Instagram. We'll get some of those shots up for you as well from Chris Dawes. Now, let's get into the games. You're with TAC Cup future stars for the TAC Speed Hurts. We're going to look through the Sandringham Dragons against the Dandenong Stingrays. And a 42-point win in this game, Jim, to the Stingrays.
Yeah, Sandy playing Dandenong. Sandringham fifth on the ladder, playing at their ground against Dandenong, who are third. It was really all about the first half. Dandenong was all over them, kicking 8-0 up until half time, and this led on to their original their winning margin of 42 points in the end. One of the key players was Maynard, left footer, wearing the number 4 if you have a look through some of these highlights. Midfielder, hard running type, great left foot on him. And he got a lot, he's a draftable age as well, and he got a lot of help from their reigning best and fairest winner, Taylor Grace, another left footer who won a lot of the footy through the midfield. But yeah, as we said, Danny just too strong in the end for Sandringham. And Shifty, just wondering who else caught your eye in this game?
Yeah, so Craig Black's doing a terrific job with the Dandenong boys. Aaron Wilson's one that's kicked 3 goals yesterday, the number 29, and he's a boy that we saw play for Vic Country during the year. Mitch White, another, playing down there in defence. Good understanding of the game. He's got the footy smarts. You like to see that. And Kyle Gray, having a very consistent year down in defence for the Stingrays, helped get them over the line.
Our second game in focus is the Calder Cannons going to battle with the Oakley Chargers. A great rivalry between these two teams. Some good kids on both lists, but it was the Cannons yesterday who got it done pretty comfortably in the end.
Yeah, Calder second versus Oakley first, so really the match of the day. Unfortunately, it didn't pan out that way at Rams Arena in Craigieburn. Calder led all day, 38-point victory, and was a really solid victory and a strong one leading into, not far off finals. Look, Paul Hearn, I thought, played quite well in this game again. He's a classy player. Didn't have as much as what he has had in some games, but certainly showed his absolute class. Play that I wanted to speak about was a young guy by the name of Hisham Kabatia. A Lebanese descent boy. He's done some work with the Bashahuli squad, and he had kicked 3 goals and had 18 disposals in this game. Shifter thought he put in a really solid performance.
Yes, he played for the world team just last year in our under-16 national championships, and at 176 centimetre. I think Bass is actually doing some mentoring with him, so that's great to see. And I want to mention Toby McLean, a boy from the Oakley Chargers. Took one of the marks of the year the other week, 20,000 hits on AFL.com on this young fella. There was a break in the TAC last weekend. He went back to Narre Warren to play and kicked a lazy 8. This boy really has emerged as a top-age player this year, and clubs are really taking a close look at him. So Toby McLean, the number 34 for the Chargers.
We might have put that on the program and have a look at it in greater detail next week. The Geelong Falcons against the Eastern Rangers. Good win by the Falcons to continue to stay in the hunt, Jimmy.
Yeah, I always keep an eye on my old team, the Geelong Falcons, and I'd like to see them do well. But they only really hit the front in the last 2 minutes. Eastern Rangers were leading all day until a late goal by the Falcons put them up, and they managed to hang on. A really interesting
play. Quite a bit of vision yourself there, Jim.
Oh, yeah, I'll bring that one in as well. My mum sent that one in, did I?
We want to look at the modern day Geelong Falcons.
Really?
We can't look back on your old days any more than we already have, Jim.
No, they don't make them like they used to do that.
Let's have a look if we can at the vision from yesterday's game.
That'd be Falcons, nice. Something in colour.
5-point win over Easton. And they are still hanging on in contention, aren't they?
Yeah, they're hanging in there. And this win was pretty important for the Falcons. And like I was saying, they were down all day until the last 2 minutes. A late goal by the Falcons, and they managed to hang on. But a really interesting battle that happened all day was young guy for the Falcons, Reece Matheson, versus probably one of the stars of the National Carnival in Christian Petracca, who's going to be a top 3 or 4 pick, as everyone was saying. And both contested ball winners and both going to go really well in future drafts. But there was a lot of boys missing for private football commitments. There was no McCartan playing and no Goddard for the Falcons. And just wondering, Kevin, if is there any other boys that are missing or could have contributed or someone catch your eye on that?
Well,
day?
I think the one that really caught the eye, Blake Hardwick, he was sensational. Kicked 8 goals, the will of the wisp up forward and a bottom age player, one to follow for next year.
Well, under the Falcons, plenty more to come on TAC Cup Future Stars for the TAC Speed Hurts. As we head to the break, it's time to slow down with Jason Castagna from the Northern Knights.
We like to play, like to be known as a hard team. Goes in hard, just gets the 1%ers done. I do art. That's probably my favourite subject, yeah. Longest yard's probably always been one of my favourite. 110. No, my mum has a habit of telling me everything I do wrong, though. Oh, obviously very important, bringing me to training, what, 3 nights a week and everything. I like a bit of athletics. The Beatles.
Speed's great on a footy field, but when you're driving a car, it's a different story. I've only had my licence for a year. I'm not very experienced.
The big thing that Dad always talked to me about was keeping a distance with the car in front. It's all about being able to react safely.
Dad kind of just says to me it's not worth getting there 30 seconds quicker to do, you know, extra 10Ks over limit when really it could save your life.
As a P-plater, there's a 30 times higher chance of being in a collision, so it's really important to keep your concentration at all times.
Just don't do it, Landy.
Well, under the Western Jets, very important road safety message and very well handled by all of the kids in the TAC Cup and their ad campaigns this year. The Western Jets were in action against New South Wales this weekend and a fascinating round of football. Again, good to see the boys get a good hit out, and the Western Jets, 14-98, were too good for the Rams, who won by 10 goals. Duggan was fantastic, kicked 3 and was named the best.
Yeah, very polished performance from Liam Duggan. I had a look at this game. He's kicked the 3, as you mentioned, but he had 24 disposals. He's a left footer like a Nicky Dell. Uses it so brilliantly, a step ahead of the others in that respect. Dylan Viojo Rainbow, the favourite name that we have for the draft this year, was impressive as well. A boy like a Matty Suckling down back that uses it very, very well on his left side. And Brenton Payne, another, thrown into a different position. We'd seen him play as a tall forward during the National Championships. He played at centre-half back, 26 disposals, 13 marks for super impressive.
I like the ability to throw at both ends so we can have a look. A couple of the New South Wales boys that I thought might be potentially draftable around the mark, Logan Austin and Jeremy Finlinson. How do they go?
Yeah, they're Giants Academy boys, and that's why the clubs are interested. They're all there having a look. These boys are 6'4", 194, 195 centimetres. Logan in defence, Finlayson up forward.
The Bushies were against Tasmania, as we take a look at the results and the action from this game, and a ripping game, 10-point win.
Yeah, Murray Knight on the ladder playing one of the invites to the TAC Cup Tasmania. Tough game all day. Murray managing to win by 10 points in the end with a 19-year-old, Dan Howe, like his namesake. Jeremy Howe from Melbourne has a bit of X factor, takes a lot of marks overhead and really takes the game on, as well as a goal of the week contender, Braden Hodgson, having a super game and really coming onto the radar for the draft combine, 185-centimetre rover. Kevin, just tell us a little bit about the McGuinness brothers from Dan and Tassie.
Good to see that Ben McGuinness, a 16-year-old in amongst the best, not to be confused with his brother Josh, an All-Australian from mid-year.
Today's games have just finished too. There's 2 games in action today in the TAC Cup as we take a look at those. And a ripping Sunday of football, North Ballarat against Queensland, 73 plays 53, a 20-point win, while Bendigo too good for the Northern Territory. We'll take a look at the rolling draft after the break right here on TAC Cup Future Stars.
Morning everyone, we're back here for TAC Cup Future Stars. The results of the goal of the week, thanks to Telstra Store Mornington, of course, is my boy Braden Hodgson, who won with this magnificent goal from outside of 50. So glad everyone saw what I was seeing.
Well done to Braden and well done to Jimmy for picking that up there. And yep, from outside 50, well done to everyone who voted on the Telstra Store Mornington Facebook page. And get in and see Pete and his team. You aren't with TAC Cup Future Stars, as Jimmy mentioned, our rolling draft player. Each and every week you put your neck on the line for the top 10.
Yeah, a few changes again. The main one was Liam Duggan, who Shifter just spoke about before. Look, if you keep playing good, solid football, you're going to get looked at. He's a nice size, a good user of the ball, and he's the one who's risen this week. Just some good vision of him here, Shifter, at a fine game yesterday.
Yes, and you've got 8 of the top 10 out of the TAC Cup. And to come back what I mentioned at the start, 50% of those invited to the draft combine come out of the TAC Cup. That's great numbers. Sandringham Dragons had 7 invited, which is a great result for them.
You had him at Richmond, who are slipping down the draft order a little bit at the moment as they keep winning, but I reckon they'd be wrapped to getting the left footer, given how they love good kicks.
Well, just absolute brilliant skills Liam Duggan's got, and he's on the rise.
No doubt. Well done, player. We'll get that up on our Facebook page too. A great innovation from Terry, the rolling draft on TAC Cup Future Stars. Shifter, your invites are going out. You're excited about this?
Yes, I think it's terrific. But look, there's some news for those that aren't invited. It's not the end, because the clubs then nominate the next 25 they want to look at. And I'd expect within another week, another 50 players will get the invite to come for state-level screening.
So the moral of the story, kids, hang in there. Tom Langdon's a good example of that. He missed out a couple, a few times on the way, and he's now a star at Collingwood.
Yes, and we can see the number of 19-year-olds that we've mentioned. Overlooked last year, these boys have bounced back and have had great years, and Dan Howe's one of those that Jimmy mentioned before.
Well done, Jim and Plough, and thanks, Shifter, again for your wonderful contribution to Under 18 football. Safe driving, slow it down on the roads. This has been TAC Cup Future Stars.